so again, partial fractions. First step is factor the denominator, then write out the partial fraction decomposition, and here's examples of how you do that, and then we solve the coefficients. So here was, we factored, wrote out the partial fraction decomposition. Again, we multiplied both sides by the least common denominator. I wrote that multiplication out on the board. From now on, we're going to go from here to here. Now, from this pink, we choose values of x to solve for a and b. That's what we did here. And then we write it out.
Could you show the matrices again, or could I just do that after class?
We can do it for the next example.
Yeah, I was just wondering.
Okay, so there's another way to do this. Like here, we chose values for x in order to cancel a and b, but I know there's at least one homework question that it won't work for. So basically, what we could do is go back to here, and we could distribute. We have distribute A, distribute B. So we have 2x plus 1 equals AX minus 5A plus BX plus 2B. And then if we group our linear terms and our constant terms together, that would be AX plus BX plus minus 5A plus 2B. And so let me do another. A plus BX minus 5A plus 2B. So from this, we basically know, from this we can say, well, 2 has to equal A plus B because those are the numbers in front of X, right? So A plus B equals 2. And then from this over here, we can say this equals 1. Okay, so we have negative 5A plus 2B equals 1. So we're just setting the constant term and the coefficient in front of the linear term equal. And so this is a system of equations, right? Like how you guys did in high school, the elimination method, the substitution method. Like if you think way back to, if you have like x plus y equals 11, 2x minus y equals 12. It's exactly like this. Elimination, substitution, but it's A's and B's. So if you want to use high school math to do that, you can, right? What would you guys do for this, for the elimination method? Just add them together to get rid of y, right? And then you could solve for x. So that's exactly what we're going to do here. Last class I did show Colin. Who's going to take linear algebra? All the math majors are raising their hands right now, right? So you can put this into a matrix. So see how we have the A's grouped and the B's grouped and then the constants grouped? So what I can do is I can take the coefficients in front of A, 1, 1, 2. So I took the coefficients in front. I just copied the coefficients to the first row. And then for the second row, I'm copying the coefficients. So this is my A column. This is my B column. And this is my, on the other side of the equals column. And then I can solve it using elimination or substitution method. That's what linear algebra is. So if you want to look at it like this, you could. If you want to look at it like this, you could. Let's get rid of this A. The goal with linear algebra is get this to be a zero. So what can I do to get this to be a zero? Well, I could say 5 times the first row plus the second row equals the second row, right? Which is something I would do here. Is this too much? No? Okay, so I could say 5 times row 1 plus row 2 equals row 2. You could do substitution elimination method from here if you want to. The thing is that linear algebra, you can put this in your calculator and do this too. And this is a skill that I think everyone in this, I think most people in this class will do linear algebra. If you're thinking about a math minor, linear algebra is a great class because it introduces you to computer programming as well. I think linear algebra, if you know how to do matrices and vectors and things like that, operations. Have you guys used MATLAB? It's what I used in grad school, and it's matrices and vector operations. You do some sort of thing, you put it in a matrix. You do some other stuff, you put it in a matrix, then you can do matrix operations. If you go to grad school for math, you have to do some sort of computer programming. Period, the end, no matter what you do. Okay, so if I do row 1 times 5, this is 5 plus row 2. So row 1 stays the same. Row 2, 5 times this plus this equals 0. That's the goal, is I want to get that to be 0 first. And now row 2, now for the this one, I say 5 times row 1. Like, this is the row 1, row 2, right? These are the columns. Okay. 5 times this plus this equals what? 7. 5 times 2 is 10, plus 1 is 11. Okay, so this is like 7b plus, 7b equals 11, right? Which is something we got over here. 7b equals 11, right? So that's where we are. How can I solve for b in this case? Solving for b means I want this to be a 1, right? 1b equals a number is solving for b. So I'm just going to say row 2 divided by 7 equals row 2. So I can multiply things and add them together. Multiply rows by things, add them together. That's what you're allowed to do in linear algebra. I'm sure you would do a proof of that somewhere in linear algebra. So then that becomes 1, 1, 2, 0, 1, 11 over 7. And I always like to, especially at the beginning, really take note of what you're doing and stay organized. Is anybody in linear algebra now? No. Okay. So I've solved for B, right? I have 1B, because this is my B column, 1B equals 11 over 7. Now I need to solve for A, right? A is this. Well, I have 1A plus B equals 2. But using these row operations, how can I solve for, how can I get this to be a 0, right? If I have 1A plus 0B, then I've solved for A, right? So if I can get this to be 1, 0, a number, I've solved for A. So I'm going to say negative row 2 plus row 1 equals row 1, right? If I say this times negative 1, or I could say row 1 minus row 2, right? So if I say this 1's going to stay the same, and that's why it's important to get this to be a 0 first, so you're not adding back and forth. So row 2, this would be negative 1, that would make this a 0, right? Which was our goal. And then negative row 2 plus row 1 equals what? Negative 11 over 7 plus 2 is what? 2 is 14 over 7. So it would be 3 over 7. And then this stays the same. Okay, so this tells us, we can translate this now back into our equations up above. A equals 3 over 7, B equals 11 over 7, because this was the A column, 1A plus 0B equals 3 over 7. So A equals 3 over 7, right? 0A plus 1B equals 11 over 7. That means B equals 11 over 7, right? So the thing is I showed you the matrix method because it's more of an advanced mathematical concept, but just like you did in high school here, solving a system of two equations, you can do elimination method or substitution method like you did in high school. The thing is, though, is once you put this, well, I don't know if I should show you guys this, but you can do also do this in your calculator for any system of equations. So let's see. It's under math. Oh, gosh, now I have to remember. Oh, no, it's, see right here? There's matrix, right? So if you go second matrix, you can edit a matrix. A. Okay, so this is rows, then columns. How many rows do I have? Two rows. Rows are this way. Rows are up and down. Two rows. Enter three columns, right? Even if you had a system of three equations with three variables, you could do this as well. This works for any system of equations. Okay, now I'm going to put, remember, it was really important that all my A's were in the same column, all my B's were in the same column. So let's go through and enter what we have. 1, enter, 1, enter, 2. Negative 5, enter, 2, enter, 1, enter. Okay, there's my matrix. Now I go back to second matrix. That's the matrix I have saved there. And then I go over to the math, and here's all the stuff you can do, which is what you'll be doing in linear algebra. And you go, this is called reduce row echelon form. Reduce row echelon form, B. Enter. Oops, sorry. You have to get out of the matrix first. I'm sorry. So go back to this screen and then go to math. Or go to matrix. Let me make sure I didn't mess that up. So once you go to the clear screen, then go back to the matrix. Then you can go to math and reduce row echelon form. And then you enter matrix A and your parentheses. And then you hit enter, and it gives it to you. So this is having the zeros on the diagonal, or having ones on the diagonal and zeros everywhere else, is called reduce row echelon form. And then, just like if we had any problem, if we wanted to get that to be a fraction, we can press fraction, enter, and it will give it to you. All right, let me show you guys one more time. Do you guys want me to show you one more time? Because you can do this for three equations, three variables, four equations, four variables. Either that or the elimination method and the substitution method is going to take you all day. But what we are doing with these, and why it's really important to keep track of them, is elimination substitution method.
So obviously if you had more variables, you'd have more equations. So say like you have
big matrix.
I'm just saying, but you could basically, so like there would just be like a third row, and so like for that one you would just have C, you just have C equal to 1. Right?
C?
Yeah, because it would be like a C if there were three variables, right?
Oh.
A, B, and C,
yeah.
So you have three equations, so like...
You would have three rows,
yeah.
Four columns. Because
yeah,
you'd have to have A, B, C equals. Yeah, I think sometimes they'll have a line like this, too. I can't remember. It's been a while. I mean, I don't remember the exact proper notation sometimes. I use it all the time. All right, so I'll show you one more time. So you go second matrix. You can have a bunch of different matrices. Like I said, multiplication of matrices. You can do a bunch of different things with different matrices. And then math is all of the operations for the matrices. And then edit is where you can enter your matrix. So again, we had a 2x3. And I went through and I entered all of those values. Right, I made sure my A was in the right column, B was in the same column, and then my on the other side of the equals is over here. So it's really important, like any math, to stay organized. Okay, and then I went second mode so I could get out of there, go back to the regular screen. And now I'm going second matrix, going to math. And this is, on my calculator, it's B, it's R, REF. That's reduced row echelon form. Reduced row echelon form means ones on the diagonal and zero everywhere else, which is you solving A equals B equals, right? This A is row echelon form, and it just means zeros on the diagonal or ones on the diagonal, but you could have numbers up above. So that's not fully solving it. So you want reduced row echelon form. Enter, and then you have to put your matrix in there. Go So go back to the matrix. I want this matrix, so I hit enter, and it's right there. And then I need to close my parentheses. And then hit enter, and it gives you the answer. And just like any math, you can go back to math and change your decimal to a fraction, and you can see it a lot nicer. So I put my my matrix in big parentheses. You can also do it in these nice square brackets too. Okay? So you could do that for all of these problems, like we did here. But I know you're going to have to do a system of equations for at least one homework problem. If you choose to do it with matrices or not, that's completely up to you. Like I said, you could do elimination substitution method from high school.
So, do we choose, say, on the test to do it anyway that we want to?
Yeah, as long as it's mathematically sound, of course. There's not just one way to do it. Right. Okay, so number two. Let's do another. I have the integral of x minus 1 equals, or x minus 1 over x plus 1 times x squared plus x plus 1 dx. All right, can I do u substitution? No. Can I do by parts? It's ugly, right? By parts, no. Right, if you did u substitution, you'd have x squared plus x plus 1. The derivative of that is x plus 1. I mean, you have the derivative of it, but that doesn't take care of the numerator at all, right? So that's not going to be a u sub. All right, so let's think partial fractions. So partial fractions, I need to factor the denominator. Yeah, can I factor any further? It needs to be fully factored, right? Is it fully factored? Can I think of anything that multiplies to 1 that adds to 1? Nothing, right? Okay, so that's fully factored. So we're going to do partial fractions. But I am trying to show that if you had this on a test, you're running through that thought process of, okay, is it a straight power rule or something from 4.9. Oh, that doesn't work. Is it u sub? Okay, it's not u sub. Okay, is it by parts? Right, you're running through that. Don't just automatically go, oh, I have to do this. Because if you look at it and go, I have to do u sub, you could struggle. Okay, so partial fractions. So I'm going to set it up x minus 1 over x plus 1 times x squared plus x plus 1. Okay, now let's go back to the first page here. Okay, so I have a linear factor, so that's a over x plus 1, and then I have an irreducible quadratic factor, okay? So I'm going to say that's plus bx plus c over x squared plus x plus 1. So if I have an irreducible quadratic, it has to be a degree less in the numerator, okay? Even though it says ax plus b up here, don't make these a's the same. Choose some different letters, right? Okay? And now the process is exactly the same. Now I'm going to multiply by the least common denominator to cancel the denominator. Again, I'm not going to do all of that algebra. X plus 1 times x squared plus x plus 1. And I'm going to distribute. And I'm just going to cancel my denominator. So I have x plus... On the left-hand side, I have x minus 1 equals a times x squared plus x plus 1 plus bx plus c times x plus 1. Did I make any mistakes? That's code for I made a mistake. Somebody find it. Who's got it? Fantastic. Bx plus c needs to be in parentheses. Really good. Okay, so now I'm going to choose values for x from this equation. I'm going to choose values for x to solve for a, b, and c. So I always like to choose easy values of x. Okay, so how about, let me see if I can crunch this over a little bit. All right, so somebody give me an easy value of x that will cancel some stuff out. Y zero. Well, it'll cancel out b at least, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so x equals 0, so I'm going to plug it in. So I have negative 1 equals a, right? 0 squared plus, do you guys want me to write out all the algebra?
Yeah.
Okay, a plus c times 1. Uh-oh, I already see that we have a system of equations, right? Okay. So I could solve this for one of them and plug into another, right? That would be the substitution method like high school. Or I can just write out a bunch of stuff. What's another easy value for x? Well, nothing here. This is irreducible. What about here?
Negative 1.
All right, so let's do negative 1. On the left-hand side, I get negative 1 minus 1, negative 2 equals a negative 1. It's just a, right? What happens here? 0, right? Oh, good. I already got what A equals, so now here I can plug that in to get what C equals, right? So I'm adding 2 to both sides, and I get 1 equals C. All right, looking good, looking good. Now I need to solve for B. This is 0 right here. So 0 times this whole thing, right? If you need to write out all the algebra, definitely write it out. Maybe I'm going a little too fast with it. Okay, so now we need to solve for C. Is there any way we can cancel everything else out? No? So what do you guys think? What should we do? Okay, so we could plug A and C in and choose a value for X, right? To solve for B. Okay, so let's choose, I always like to choose the easy values. I'm not choosing 1/2. I don't need to do fractions, right? If X equals 1, that's nice algebra. So we're going to choose X equals 1 and plug in A and C. Okay. Do I have it right so far? Good. All right, so now I'm going to add 6 to both sides and then divide by 2. Is that okay? And now I'm going to subtract 1 from both sides. If you want to write out the algebra in 100 steps, it doesn't matter, right? As long as the algebra is legit. So here from here, I did negative 2 times 3 is negative 6. I added 6 to both sides, and then I divided by 2. Okay, so now I solve for A, B, and C. So our integral of, I'm just going to rewrite what we have up above. So we've completed the partial fraction decomposition, and we found an equivalent form of our integral, which is negative 2 over x plus 1. So I'm going back to this equation, and I'm plugging in a and b. So negative 2 over x plus 1 plus b is 2 and c is 1 over x squared plus x plus 1 dx. All right, so now that we've done partial fraction decomposition, now we need to look at this and go, okay, is it easier, and what methods do I need in order to integrate? So what do you guys think about this first one? It's just like number one. We're going to do a u sub. I'm going to call it u1. u1 equals x plus 1 du1 equals dx. So I didn't write this out fully out last time because I didn't have enough room. So this equals negative 2 over u du. So I'm breaking this up into two separate integrals, right? Plus, oh, that's u1. The integral. What do you guys think about this? How can we integrate this? U sub. Give me some more info. Perfect. That's like the base example for u sub, right? Perfect. So I'm going to call it u2. Or we could call it w if that works better for you. Okay? So this integral becomes 1 over u2 du2. We can integrate those, right? What's 1 over the integral of 1 over u? Good. Same thing here, right? So I have negative 2 ln of the absolute value of u1 plus ln of the absolute value of u2 plus c. All right. Now we need to back sub, which is why it's so important to stay organized, right? So I have negative 2 ln of the absolute value of x plus 1 plus ln of the absolute value of u2, which is x squared plus x plus 1 plus c. What do you guys think? All right, let's do another then. All right, so the different examples we're doing here are different ways to write out the partial fraction decomposition, right? That's what I'm trying to show. All right. And it's nice because everything's already factored for us, which I would not anticipate is how it really works in the real world. That's a real factor, right? Okay. So I don't see any u sub unless I want to square this and multiply by this. Then I could happen to see if the derivative of the numerator happens to be the denominator, but that seems like a lot of work. So I'm going to do partial fractions. So partial fraction. Okay, so everybody look at the first page and try to write out your partial fraction decomposition. Because the denominator is already factored, right? Bless you. All right, did I get it right? Does it make sense?
I thought the second one would have had the bx plus c because it's the second degree.
It's repeated linear factors. It's a repeated linear factor. It shows up each time until you get to the power that it shows up. Right? If this was like to the fifth, I'd have a over b over c over until I get up to the fifth power. All right. All right, now multiply by the least common denominator and see what your equation is. I've been boxing that equation into pink, in pink, because then we're choosing values based on that equation for x.
Would that be over x times 2, would that be squared?
It's a repeated linear factor. All right, so here's my multiplication. Is it good? So now I'm going to choose values of x to solve for a, b, and c. And I'm going to write those three pieces out, right? Somebody tell me some values for x that are going to look good.
2.
2. X equals 2. Will help us solve for b. Good. What's another value of x that will be easy? X equals negative 1. X equals negative 1, we can solve for c. So we're going to have to do a little something extra, right? Like we did in the last problem, plug in a, plug in b, and choose another value for x to solve for the other one. Okay? So I want you guys to try it. Try it on your own. Raise your hand if you got A.
Mm-hmm.
chain if you got A. What'd you get? 19/9. So check your algebra, see what you guys think. So then my next step after I figured out what A, B, and C are was I rewrote my fraction using my partial fraction decomposition. The integral of this equals the integral of this, right, A. Uh-oh. Sorry. Oops. Okay, so the integral of A, my A is 19/9, plus this, my B is 17/3, plus this, C is 8/9. So I could have written this as one integral, but each of these is a separate U substitution, so that's why I wanted to do them as separate integrals. Okay, are you guys going to try to do the U sub? I'll do W, U instead of U1, U2. Do W, DW. So the integral of 9, so are we all good? This is a lot of work, I know. It's a lot of stuff. So are we good up till here? Okay, so the integral of 19/9 divided by u is 19/9 ln of the absolute value of u. What's the integral of 17/3 w to the -2 dw? What is it, AJ? No, you got it. You just did the substitution. Okay, so it's W to the -1.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got it.
Yeah, 1/W.
Yeah. And then you put the negative out in front. Good. And then here you have 8/9 ln of the absolute value of y plus c. Okay, now we need to back sub. Holy cow. So if you can, I'm writing out the substitution each time, but if you can do it without, right, like this is a pretty clear U sub. This is a pretty clear ln. These are both clear ln's. This is clearly the power rule, so I do think it's important to show the substitution for this one, but these ones I don't think it's necessarily. for Ellen.
Normal trig function, you don't need to show it.
As long as you're verifying, because if this is 2 minus x, du play comes into play, right? Because du would be at the negative 1. So make sure you're checking that du is 1 and not something else. All right. Whew. It's a long one. You guys feel okay about it? All right, we've got 5 more minutes. We can finish this section. Just kidding. All right, this one is very, very similar to the previous. Ones. Who can help me factor? Perfect. Thanks. So here it's not a U sub, it's not a straight up power rule, right? I don't see a function in its derivative for U sub. It's just partial fractions. Okay, so can somebody walk me through this? Right, you want to give it a shot? Okay. Who else? Somebody want to give it a shot? Can somebody tell me the partial fraction decomposition? Kevin?
It's going to be a over x squared plus b over x. Is that c?
So I have x squared. That's a repeated linear term, right? So it's x minus 0, right? So it's a over x plus b over x squared plus c over x minus 7. All right, and now I'm going to multiply both sides of the equation by my least common denominator and cancel. Now I'm going to choose some values for x. What are the easy values of x you guys see? What do you think, David? X equals 7, because that will cancel this term out and make these two 0. That will make it really easy to solve for C, right? What's another value of X you see that could be really easy? 0, because that will cancel out this one, cancel out this one, so you'll be able to solve for B. So we'll just need a little trickery like we did to solve for A, right? So X equals 7. This one's nice. So I'm going back to this equation that I boxed in pink in order to see, to plug these values in to see what I get. Now I just need to solve for A, right? So I always go x equals 1. Easy, right? So I say x equals 1, that's a times 1a. If this is 1, I have 1 minus or 1 minus 7, so I get negative 6 times A. What'd you guys get? Okay, class is over, but I'll finish. Yeah, negative. I'll finish writing it. I know some people have class after this. But this one, I think looking at this one, I'm going to change that to the first problem next class because this is the easiest that we've done.
Isn't B supposed to be negative 7?
B is negative 7?
Yeah, but you have it as negative 6 and negative 6.
What? It's negative 7 here, and then this is 1 minus, because I plugged in x equals 1. All right, have a good weekend, y'all. Stay warm.
Huh?
Oh, yeah, let me write it down. Like more for the younger kids. I'll write it down. Yeah, have a good weekend.
Oh yeah, I maybe probably next week, but I need help. I don't really understand how we're getting like this.
How we're doing? Okay, yeah.